We're going to talk about some potential shortfalls, and the panel members will address those as those questions come up. And then we're going to discuss some of the mitigation strategies that we're putting in place and some of the training programs that we're putting in place to go ahead and mitigate some of these shortfalls. So what will happen is each one of the panel members will give some brief opening comments and as we work our way through the deployment process, and then we'll open up to Q&A. But first, I want to introduce all the panel members. The panel host, Lieutenant General Gus Perna, who is the Army G4. We've got Lieutenant General Patrick Donahue, who is the Deputy Commanding General for Forces Command. We've got Mr. Mark Signorelli, Vice President and General Manager, Combat Vehicles, BAE Systems. We've got Mr. Eric Eibling, who's the President and CEO of American Roll-On, Roll-Off. And then we've got Lieutenant General Steve Lyons, the Deputy Commanding General of Transcom. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Lieutenant General Perna for some opening remarks, sir.
So good morning to everybody. I appreciate the participation by everybody in this great event, this annual AUSA event here in Huntsville. It's been remarkable. General Sullivan, sir, I know it's been many times people have acknowledged you and thanked you, but I'm going to do it again. I was not lucky enough in my tenure when you were the chief to really understand your impact, as I was a young captain at the time. But I've been rewarded with being around you for the last 5 or 6 years, and your contributions to the United States Army have been without equal. And I just want to say thank you very much for all that you've done. Okay, we have a great panel today. I really want to say thanks to the panel members for making time to be a part of this discussion. We're going to talk about our ability to execute deployment operations. And we're going to take it from the fort to the port, the port to the port, and then the port to the foxhole. And you might say to yourself, hey, we've been doing this for years, you know, in Iraq and Afghanistan. And yes, we have been deploying over there to two wars. But I would suggest we haven't been doing it the way we need to be prepared to do it in the future. General Vi talked about yesterday where we are around the world and what we're doing. And who do we have to be prepared to do it against? And what will we not have when that time comes? The R4 Gen model served us well while we were fighting those two wars. But it won't serve us as we need to be ready to execute expeditionary deployment and then expeditionary operations. And so what does that mean to us? How do we get ready for this? So first, we have to make sure we have a plan to execute operations, deployment operations. Two, we need to make sure we have the infrastructure that's capable of pushing out our forces, both at the home stations and then where we're going to be received at, if possible. Third, we need to make sure we have the capability to execute the deployment operations, the partnerships that are required with Transcom, the partnerships that are required with industry to do locomotive. We have to make sure that there's synergy there so that we can develop our requirements and then they can meet it for us, right? And then the fourth, we need to exercise. We need to exercise this capability so that we can see the seams and the gaps and then we can mitigate them before the emergency hits. And if we can do that, we'll be prepared for the next operation. But the basic assumption is that we're going to go someplace where these capabilities are not currently in existence. And as we bring ourselves out of the R4 Gen model, we have to develop from the ground up those four things. And it'll start with discussions like this today and then be pushed into the Army so that we regain this requirement. And as we do this, we'll get better and better and better, and we have to exercise it. But exercising it costs money, it takes time, and it will take everybody's effort to get us to where we need to be. Now, while I have industry here, I want to talk a little bit about how you can contribute to this. And I'm not going to tell you anything that you don't know already. But what's important is we develop equipment that we have to deploy. We want to maintain the protection, we want to maintain the mobility, but we must figure out a way to make it lighter. Taking an 80-ton tank to war is not an easy task, right? And we must figure out how to make things lighter. Second, we must figure out how to develop systems that require less resources to operate. We have to reduce the requirement for fuel. We have to draw that down, and we have to be able to extend ourselves into lines of communication. If we could figure out how to reduce the fuel requirements, we could figure out how to take less things with us. Third, we need to make sure that our equipment is interoperable. We have to be able to lessen the supply chain, shorten the supply chain, lessen the requirement, and develop equipment where the parts are interoperable with each other. And then last, I think it's time that the Army seriously take the lead in additive manufacturing. And we need to take our arms and put it around this technique, and we need to embrace it so that we can shorten and reduce the supply chain to meet our requirements. Those four things, with industry help, will help us be better strategic deployers. So with that said, I'm going to turn it back over to General Shapiro.
Sir, thank you very much for your opening remarks. And now we're going to go through each one of the segments that you see up there on the slides. So I'm going to turn it over to Lieutenant General Donahue to talk about pre-deployment activities. Sir.
Well, thank you very much. And I'd like to thank General Perna for inviting me to be on this panel. And like him, sir, I'd like to thank AUSA for hosting this venue. It provides a tremendous opportunity for us to talk about the challenges and opportunities facing our Army right now. And I appreciate this is, again, a great event. So I am from Forces Command, and I'd like to start off by saying Forces Command has a new mission. We just got it approved by the Chief Staff of the Army, and it reflects readiness for the first time. For all of you former ForceCom soldiers out there, our mission statement has never included the word readiness in it. Now it does. So it reads now, our ForceCom trains and prepares a combat-ready, globally responsive total force to build and sustain readiness to meet combatant commander requirements. So let me talk about why we went to that through a little story. You know, we've been meeting COCOM commander requirements for the last 13 years. They were the rotationally focused requirements. So a brigade at Fort Lewis under our previous focus would receive an order from Forces Command to go to Diyala and in 14 months. So that brigade would start focusing on that rotational mission. So it would train on search and attack, it would cordon and knock, it would learn all the tribal dynamics of the Sunnis and the Shias in that province, understand the Kurd Arab friction up in Kanakin and the Sunni-Shia friction down in Kallus, and understand the capabilities of the 5th Iraqi Army Division. And train to the tasks that were required to do those types of missions. And so it was, you know, cordon and knock, cordon search, you know, key leader engagements, working with the PRT, et cetera. What it didn't do was a combined arms breach, a table 18, which required a battalion, artillery battalion, to do a battalion TOT, a time on target. It didn't do a deliberate attack, a deliberate defense. And also, the way that brigade deployed, it would do its training at the CTC and often just go back, drop its stuff off, its gear back at home station, fly over to theater and follow it on theater provided equipment. So like General Perna was saying, yes, we've been deploying a lot, but the way we've been deploying is not useful for the world we live in right now. We have gotten rusty in our ability to deploy units and their equipment. So General Abrams has created a little motto that helps guide us. ForceCom units will be surge ready and rotationally focused. So the surge ready piece is where we have to get into the deployment readiness. So once again, we are now focusing on units on their ability to execute a TPFID in support of a COCOM commander's operational plan. We haven't been doing that for a while. And so now we are. So now that brigade from JBLM with a mission to go to Iraq to train Iraqi Army soldiers in the vice and sys role will first train to decisive action. So it will do deliberate attack. It will do a defense. It will do the artillery battalion will do that battalion TOT. Because you never know when it'll get the call that goes somewhere besides that to that rotational mission. So we are training on our core mission essential task list again to include our ability to deploy, both the unit's ability to deploy and the installation's ability to deploy off its installation. So surge ready, rotationally focused is a key thing I want to leave with you today. That's what we're focusing on here in Forces of Command as we build readiness. So how are we doing that? Let me get back to, you know, I'll talk a little bit about some of the EDV programs we're doing. Very essential to keep it real, make a unit truly deployable. We've been focusing recently on our units with the prepare to deploy missions for various COCOM commanders, including NORTHCOM. And for instance, in last month, we deployed alerted the brigade in 82nd, the Global Response Force. Marshall deployed, and we actually sent a battalion to Fort Hood. They jumped in along with elements of the 20th Suburban, and did a weapons of mass destruction elimination mission. Okay, and the rest of the brigade did its joint inspection with the Air Force and prepared for air land. We had the aircraft. Also, in the last three weeks, we had an air defense brigade with a prepared to deploy mission. We alerted them within their timeline and actually deployed them to PACOM's AOR with a minimum engagement package. We have never done that before. We got in the theater and they did an operational readiness exercise, got great training out of it. Our most ambitious EDRE we're doing is right now. We had a brigade from the 101st who thought they were going to JRTC in April, as they always do, with contracted line haul and contracted rail. Last week, we alerted them to deploy via sea. And so they are shaking off all sorts of dust and knocking off all sorts of rust as they develop a rediscover, in some cases, probably most cases, their ability to send their 800 vehicles and 200 containers, first by rail to Jacksonville, load them on a ship, sail them to Port Arthur, Texas, download them, and bring them into JRTC that way. So in the process, we're getting a lot of, I won't steal all of General Lyon's thunder here, but we're working closely with Transcon to make this work. We're both getting benefit out of doing this. But you know, we're working with our 7th Trans Brigade to operate the port of embarkation in Jacksonville. And we're using this JTF port opening capability at the port of debarkation in Texas. So we're actually executing the whole process from fort to port and see if we can make it work. So anyway, I'd be happy to answer any questions, but just again, want to end. ForceCom is still focused on meeting COCOM commander requirements. We still will do the rotational requirements, but now we're adding the surge requirements as well. And really, that's our focus. Our initial focus for all our training and our readiness is to do that. And then when we finish our ability to, you know, to get up to our core metal tasks, then we train, you know, to be able to understand the tribal dynamics in Diyala afterwards. Then we start training on our assigned mission. That's a big change from how we've been doing training and building readiness in Forces Command in the last 13 years. So thank you very much. I'll pass it back to the moderator.
Sir, thank you very much. We appreciate that. So the next segment is going to be the Ford to Port, and we're going to turn it over to Mr. Signorelli for opening remarks. And his focus will be on the challenges with deployability of combat vehicles, size, weight, configuration limitations, and developing the rapidly deployable and employable vehicles to operate globally. Sir, over to you.
Great. Thanks very much. And General Perna, thanks for the opportunity to address this this gathering again this year. It's an interesting perspective as vehicle developers, as we look at the challenges of developing a more expeditionary mindset in our forces and in the platforms that we develop. During the war surge, you heard a lot of discussion about the iron triangle for vehicles, and that's weight, protection, and payload. And within those three parameters, you could make a lot of changes, but the shape or the total area didn't change very much. And that's still true today. Those three constraints still drive largely the development of a new system. I think the one change that we're beginning to realize is that we've now added another constraint in there that wasn't necessarily a driver during that period, which is cost. So the iron triangle has really become the iron pyramid. And as we develop systems, we have to pay increasing amounts of attention to the cost, the total cost of a system. And that translates into requirements. And as you look at you've heard a lot of discussion about the acquisition system and how it works or may not work as well. The entry point for all of that are requirements. So we try to focus as much as we can with our users and our customers on requirements and having them understand what an integrated set of requirements means, especially in the area of deployability. And I'll just use a quick example. So if you start with a vehicle like a Bradley, something that I'm a little familiar with, and then you start to make just one change, and that is we're going to go from the 1980 size Soldier that the Bradley was designed against to the 2015 Soldier. So what does that do? That Soldier goes from 5'10 to 6'4 for the large male and goes to a weight of about 240 pounds. Now, given new protection requirements, you add head clearance, you add seat stroke, you add 2 inches of clearance around the entire size of that Soldier, and the resulting vehicle is now a GCV. And I think many of you have seen what the impact of that is on the deployability of a vehicle. There's a huge difference between a Bradley and a GCV. That's just one example of how a single requirement change, which on the surface seems relatively simple, can ripple through the entire vehicle design. So I think we continue to emphasize and would ask for a lot of consideration about what the integrated set of requirements is for vehicle development. The second thing is reliability. We see increasing pushes to add capability to platforms. And in general, yes, more capability is good, but in most cases, more capability adds complexity. And complexity challenges reliability. If you have reliability issues, now you're starting to see spares, troubleshooting equipment, the size of the ASL and PLLs go up, the number of repairs go up in a formation. So again, in terms of system trades, it's a balance between what you can do, what capability you can add, what the impact of that is, and where is the balance in those requirements. And the third thing I'd point out is commonality and supportability. In the Armored Brigade Combat Team, which is where the majority of my platforms reside, we've made very significant advances over the last couple of years in commonality among the major systems in that formation. Bradley, PIM, M109A7, and AMPV will all use a common set of automotive and suspension components. Significantly reduces the number of MOSs needed to support the organization, the number of repair parts, the number of line replaceable units, and allows the Army to realize benefits as one of those platforms pays to upgrade a component, improve the reliability or capabilities, then we've made a very concerted effort to make sure that that's forward and backward compatible across the entire formation, which again helps to drive the ability to support those systems after they have deployed. It probably will shock a number of folks here that as we extend that approach beyond just the BAE systems platforms, there's an ongoing and active program between Bradley and Abrams to ensure the commonality of the Gen 3 FLIR systems and lethality systems on Abrams and Bradley have common components. And believe it or not, it actually was something that General Dynamics and BAE Systems have been pushing for 5 or 6 years, and we're starting to have the opportunity where we can realize that kind of synergy and commonality. And I think that does represent the industry's perspective that these kind of challenges are not unique to any one provider or developer, but they are in fact common across all of the developers and are issues that we're willing to take on collectively. But we do require a lot of support from our customers, from the acquisition community, from the user community as well, in order for us to be able to successful in developing those capabilities. I guess just one other comment in closing. General Sullivan, on behalf of myself, my team, and the millions of soldiers and their families that you've supported throughout your career, I'd just like to say thank you for your service.
Sir, thank you very much for your insightful comments. I'm going to now turn it over to Mr. Ebeling, who's going to talk about the state of the sealift industry and some of the challenges in supporting DOD. Sir.
So thank you. Good morning, and thank you to AUSA for the opportunity to be here. I'm going to start by talking a little bit about ARC, but I'd like to keep most of my comments focused on the U.S. flag commercial fleet overall. Going to talk a little bit about our network, the overall fleet's network, as well as a little bit about past performance, and then close with the some comments on the importance of partnering. So the U.S. flag fleet, commercial fleet, is crewed by the U.S. Merchant Marine. ARC is the largest U.S. flag railroad carrier, roll-on, roll-off carrier, operating in the international trades, and we're the third largest carrier, in the U.S. flag fleet overall. There are presently 78 ships in the U.S. flag international fleet. In the international fleet, it's important to separate that, and it's distinct from the domestic or Jones Act trade, which is only between points in the continental U.S. and overseas territories and states. Of those 78 ships in the international fleet, 58 are in the Maritime Security Program, or MSP. As recently as 4 or 5 years ago, there were closer to 120 ships in the international fleet. So we've had some atrophy in the fleet overall. A little bit about ARC. We have 7 of the 16 RoRos that are in the U.S. flag international fleet. Those 7 ships represent 49% of the total square foot capacity in that fleet. We operate, our primary service is a 5-ship service in the Atlantic trades, but we also operate periodically in Oceania and Asia and the Mideast as well. Our major customers, in addition to the Department of Defense, and this is not just ARC, but it's all commercial carriers, are the Department of State, Foreign Military Sales and Foreign Military Financing, Federal Transit Administration, Ex-Im Bank, and of course, commercial cars, mining equipment, oil and gas sector, and agriculture. Our line of service over the past few years has supported a number of exercises and rotations that will be familiar to this audience, including but not limited to Atlantic Resolve, Trident Juncture, Cold Response, as well as the ERI, EAS, and APS rotations that have been taking place over the past few years. One of the things that we're excited about right now is we're bringing in a new ship called the AIDA into the U.S. flag fleet at the end of this month. That ship has a 20-foot door opening and has a 240-ton ramp. General Perna mentioned the importance, the weight of the M1A1 tanks. Well, when one of those tanks is inoperable, the only thing that can tow a tank is another tank. So that 240-ton ramp tends to come in handy. So those ships can carry anything from the aforementioned Bradley fighting vehicles to the CH-47s to really anything in the arsenal right now. I'd like to talk a little bit about liner service. Liner service is any regularly scheduled point-to-point service. For container ships, it's usually weekly. For RoRo, it's usually somewhere between weekly and fortnightly. Our Atlantic service is a 10-day frequency. The importance of liner service is it's basically synonymous with readiness. We're not just there for the bright, shiny objects. We're there for the onesies and twosies, as well as those 100 to 150 square foot unit moves as well. So while we may be on the water, we really exist to bring the Army to the fight and sustain it. Those services, I'm supposed to be talking mostly port to port, but those services really go well beyond just port to port. A few of the things that the international fleet has done over the past few years include inlands in Iraq in support of OIF, PAC-GLOC, Sea Air Multimodal, the Northern Distribution Network, and other logistics services. Those were all done in partnership with Transcom and mostly under the Universal Services Contractor, USC. So some of those services were already in place as commercial for other commercial business, but the carriers also built a number of those services from scratch to support DoD requirements. It may surprise this audience to learn that ARC and the other U.S. flag commercial carriers actually carried over 90% of the OIF and OEF sustainment since 2009. So I think important for this audience perhaps to note that the Army's equipment deploys on ships like ours, commercial ships, so it's important to practice that way as well. The key drivers of OIF and OAF commercial services, or one of the key drivers, was the fact that U.S. government owned or controlled, aka organic ships or chartered ships, cannot call on many ports, including such ports over the years as Karachi, Pakistan, and Umkasar, Iraq. And there's also, of course, a desire to sometimes have a limited or no logistics footprint in certain AORs. So commercial carriers can go to places that organic lift either can't go and or that boots on the ground can't go as well, or that we may choose not to go to, so to limit that footprint. So PAC-GLOC and the NDN services, those were actually developed by the commercial carriers working closely with our partners at Transcom. Primarily by container carriers up front, but they were later expanded to RoRo and breakbulk, although, at least in terms of OEF, most of the cargo went via air or via sea air multimodal. Sea air multimodal was actually, ARC was actually the first carrier to do one of those moves, not to digress too much, but it was a pretty interesting move. Just to give you a little bit of the idea of how these things work, ARC did the inlands in CONUS, we did the ocean to the port of Antwerp in Belgium. We did the trucking down to the airport in Brussels. We worked with an air partner to move the cargo from Brussels to Navoi, Uzbekistan. And then we did the logistics down into Afghanistan from there. So pretty complex moves, and that was just for moving AM2 matting. So it gets even more complex when you're talking about certain systems. We're also a major mover of personal property, not just ARC, but the entire commercial fleet. That includes household goods and POVs as well. ARC Logistics actually, through our AAL brand, ran the global POV contract from 1998 to 2014, among other things. Originally, that was bid due to the importance of the ocean shipping concept. So it really is end-to-end logistics that you're getting from the U.S. flag commercial fleet. The key sealift programs we work with are the Maritime Security Program, which I already mentioned, and the Voluntary Intermodal Sealift Agreement, or VISA. All of our sealift programs are really dependent on smart legislation and smart policy. MSP is currently authorized to have up to 60 militarily useful ships. One of the great things about this is that the attendant intermodal networks basically come with that for free. And each ship in the fleet comes with two active crews, and those crews, those are the mariners that then crew the government reserve ships when those are activated in time of need. So it's really a tremendous example of public-private partnering, and it's a $65 billion cost avoidance. That's a B, not an M, cost avoidance to DOD for the ships and the global intermodal networks. I'll close by just saying briefly that Transcom is our primary interface with the Department of Defense. And I'll also note that there's a new group there called the Enterprise Readiness Center, headed by Colonel Chris Rogers. That is essential to us as the industry entry point. So we also work very closely with the Transcom's Army component, SDDC. Industry organizations are also essential, the National Defense Transportation Association, or NDTA in particular. And I'll just close by saying government and industry are really interdependent. Without a viable U.S. merchant marine industry, DOD would really not have the capability to deploy and deliver the Army. So look forward to your questions, and thank you again for the opportunity to be here.
Sir, thank you very much. I'm going to turn it over now to Lieutenant General Lyons, Deputy Commander of Transcom, to talk about the Fort Foxhole portion. Sir?
It just goes.
I think you're on, sir.
How's it go? Okay. Sorry about that. I also want to thank my good friend, General Perna, here for inviting me back to Team Army, as well as General Sullivan for all you do in AUSA, and General Vine, Commander Sergeant Major Sims. Thanks for great hospitality here at Team Huntsville. I am extraordinarily, I think, frankly, I tell people I have the best job anybody could possibly have. I'm really proud to represent U.S. Transcom and its four components. So SCDC, I think, is well understood, and General Davidson's somewhere in the audience. I saw her a little bit ago. The Military Sealift Command is our maritime component, and then Air Mobility Command as our air component. And you say, well, Lyons, you said four components. And I did, and because General McDew often refers to the fourth component as to exactly what Eric was talking about, and that's commercial industry, and I'll come back to that here in a little bit. But it's great to be part of one of those nine COCOMs out there. General Perna gave me exactly 5 minutes. He's a tough taskmaster. And so I wrote down a couple notes, and I'll make a few points, and I'll leave time for questions. And so I'll just make three quick points. I couldn't pass the opportunity to do a little bit of Transcom 101. So the slide up there that you see and I'm looking at, I'll just describe to you really quick. Around the globe are the six unified command plan missions that U.S. Transcom has. The globe really represents, I think, a pretty good icon of a global distribution network. And on the right side of the slide, you see really the characteristics of a global distribution network. And I always attribute this back to Lieutenant General Bobby Dale, retired, who I think had a great construct, and this has developed over time. But as you think about distribution and deployment, you really have to think about a network of multiple routes, modes, nodes, all in depth, providers like ARC and others, DLA and the services, all underpinned by a very mature IT architecture. And so when we think about capability, it's really important to think about that as a architecture in terms of a network. And when we think about vulnerabilities, we also have to think about it in terms of a network. So as we believe that we're going to become more and more contested over time by what DepSecDef often refers to as great power competition, this network has to be addressed either in terms of protection or in terms of increased resiliency and redundancy. And the design really is, and I'll get back to this in a minute, is really about getting the Army to the fight. And I think General McDew would certainly say that if you were here. So first question I think General Perna alluded to is capability. Can we get the Army to the fight? And so I think that's a reasonable question. And as I look at and assess today, and we've done those assessments, can we get the Army to the fight from a U.S. Transcom perspective, the answer is yes. And so there's a series of mobility capability assessments that have been done over the years. They all come up to similar results in terms of the ability to move the Army to the fight. 20 million square feet of railroad space, as Eric was talking about. He's got a portion of that. Ability to surge on about 36,000 containers, 86 petroleum tankers, those kinds of things. So the math tells us, as well as the air fleet, which is a combination of organic and craft partners, the math tells us that we have the capacity today to do that. So the next question really ought to be, how about the future? How about 5, 10 years from now? What do we need to be thinking about? So the Army, I would say, has huge equities in U.S. Transcom. And I'll just highlight a couple challenges that we probably ought to be thinking about as we head down the road. And these are some of the things I'll probably talk to Congress about next week. So to meet the Army concerns for the future, and if I were talking to the Air Force, it would really be a little different. It would be aerial refuel, it would be the Ajax, the C-17, those kinds of things. But I think for the United States Army, back to what Eric was just talking about, it is the U.S. merchant fleet. The U.S. flag merchant fleet is on the decline in a way that we've seen up and down swings, but is at an all-time low. And we're approaching the threshold of being able to produce the merchant mariners that Eric talked about that will crew the United States Navy organic ready reserve fleet and surge fleet, to include the preposition fleets that are out in the ocean right now. And so that's probably concern number one. You might say, as an Army, why do I care about the merchant fleet and why do I care about the mariners? Because those are the mariners that are going to carry the fight. And the commercial augmentation piece of this under Visa is a portion. It's about 5 million square feet of railroad space in addition to container space and those kinds of things. So that'd be point number one I'd leave you with. The second point is the age out of the organic fleet. The Military Sealift Command's fleet will age out. Beginning really in about mid-2020s, we're engaging with the Navy and Congress to come up with a strategy really to recapitalize that fleet. We know we're going to have to do that so we don't lose the capacity we have today to get the Army to the fight. And then last point I leave you with is really I think the emerging joint operating environment that you've heard about over the last couple of days and in many different forums will change the nature of how we conduct logistics. Our strategic logistics base is a function of commercial proxy, and it will always be that way. We cannot afford to buy organically what we have with commercial capacity, merchant marines, other kind of capabilities. And so as we look at a contested environment, perhaps that we haven't been contested before in terms of air, maritime, space, and cyber, we've got to rethink about either how we protect it or how we build it in such a way that's resilient, redundant, and sufficient to deliver the Army to the fight. And we're doing that, actually, and we're at the direction of the SecDef. We'll do one of seven strategic portfolio reviews this year in 16, U.S. Transcom-led, to take a look at strategic mobility in a contested environment, and then also a tag-along to address the recapitalization of the sealift fleet. And I think that was my three points. What I would leave you with was, Army's got huge equities in U.S. Transcom. There's no question about it. Two, General McDougall, if he were here, would tell you that the joint distribution and deployment enterprise that we have today is built around the ability to get the United States Army to the fight. There's no question about that. And third is the United States Army is the foundational backbone, make no mistake about it, for joint logistics in the operational and tactical theater. So with that, happy to take any questions, and thanks again, Gus, for inviting me.
Sir, thank you very much. Now, we did have some questions come in from the audience, so I'm going to go run through there and go to a panel member and then open up for comment to other panel members. First question, sir, is for General Perna. Sir, how can the Army shift towards an expeditionary mindset and improve on its ability to conduct deployment redeployment operations?
So first, I think we have to really see ourselves, and we have to understand the world, as we talked about. Clearly, the environment's changing, and we have to be ready to go tonight, not to overuse that catchphrase, but I think the importance of it needs to be understood, and how does that translate to the things we talked about up here? Second, we need to assume, my opinion, that we will be contested wherever we go. And that the enemy will not make the mistake of allowing us to go someplace close by and settle in and get ready to go. So we need to understand that. And then third, we need to see ourselves. We need to understand that these are new skills that we have to relearn, and that we have to train and then execute those skills. And so some of the things that are occurring is, one, deployment operations are being added back onto the mission essential task list. So units have to train to execute deployment operations. Two, as my colleague talked about, we have to be able to execute CDRs and EDRs. The Chief of Staff of the Army has directed CDRs and EDRs at the BCT level. We were skirting around the capability with the executing company and some battalion EDRs. He upped the ante, and now we're going to execute BCT. And so I think that start will help us move forward. But then, as General Lyons ended his conversation, it is the ability to partner with the capability that's going to make it happen. And as he said, I believe strongly, after looking at this for the last 18 months, that the capability is there. And now we have to exercise it to make sure that we're ready to do it. So,
sir, thank you. Sir, another, I think, somewhat of a follow-on question. I'd like to get your thoughts and then maybe go to General Donahue for his thoughts. How does the Army get back to basics in regard to deployments? Sir?
Me? Well, as I talked about first, many of the people in the audience are older, like the panel. And so our reflections in general are of the days when we had to load out equipment. We had to make sure our equipment was ready. We had to load out our equipment. We had to get to the railheads and make sure we were rail and air certified. We had to understand load plans on how we wanted the equipment loaded on ships so that when we got to where we wanted, the equipment came off when we needed it. That skill set is lost. And so it is literally back to the basics and making sure we understand how to do that. And so I know, Pat, you'll add on to that.
Thank you. Agreed. If we make it important to us, it'll be important to them. And that's what we're doing right now with the EDRI program that Forces Command is developing, in close coordination, by the way, with their headquarters, EAG4. That's where the money's coming from these things. So thank you very much. So now, what I didn't talk about was that this also requires not only the unit to get ready, but it requires insulation to get ready. Yep. And we have really atrophied in our ability of the insulations to push us out, because we have not been doing it. We've done something we called a CDRE, but it was like to move 57 vehicles down to a ship and do static loading. That just kind of scratches the itch, but that doesn't really satisfy the requirement. So we haven't really stressed our systems, both in the units and in the installations, for doing this task. The third thing I didn't talk about is this requires a total force solution. We are looking at using the U.S. Army Reserve capabilities in the CDRE we're doing. They're providing some bunch of units I never even knew existed, like a seaport operations company, an automated cargo detachment, and an expeditionary terminal opening element. They're rolling out, and they're going to be at our seaport of embarkation to actually do all the planning, the loading, and the stowing, as they would for real. And so this is a good example and a good opportunity to exercise the total Army as well as the active force and installations. Thank you.
Sir, thank you very much. Sir, a question for BAE, Mr. Signorelli. Sir, I think you alluded to this, I think, during your opening remarks. The M1A2 tank consumes roughly 300 gallons every 8 to 12 hours. Given all recent advancement in the private sector, what initiatives are occurring across the combat vehicle industry to reduce fuel energy requirements while improving endurance? Sir.
So I think the M1 is probably the big or the long pole in the tent. I think we have seen significant advances in technology in the last 20 years. I actually think it hasn't been before that, but until then, the turbine engine was the way to get the kind of performance that the M1 needed. I think now, as we look at some of the high power density diesel systems that are available in the commercial marketplace, and high-efficiency transmissions. TARDEC has done a lot of work towards the development of high-efficiency transmissions. Similarly, in the commercial world, there are some. When you start to match those capabilities together, then you can start to be able to achieve the same kind of performance required for the M1. The other branch of technology is around electric drives. And the ability to have a scalable, reconfigurable power system that could potentially be common across a wide range or a large family of vehicles using electric drive technology. And there, interestingly enough, I get a lot of questions about electric drives as being driven by fuel efficiency. It really isn't. The driver for electric drives is performance. You actually get better performance from electric drives than you do even from a turbine system. But along with that, you get about a 20% cost savings in fuel efficiency, not over the turbine, but over modern high power density diesels. So I think there are technologies out there. It's a big step. And I think one of the things that industry's in discussion, both with PEOGCS and TARDEC, is, what is the mechanism to begin to modernize some of that technology? And are there opportunities to have, for instance, a common engine across Bradley, AMPV, PIM, and Abrams using an electric drive system?
Sure, thank you. Sir, I've got a question here, General Lyons. I'd like to give it to you first and then over to Mr. Ebeling. Should industry be part of the upfront requirements process? If so, how would you integrate industry partners during requirements development, sir?
Yeah, I think from a Transcom perspective and what our JDPAC does to generate requirements in our models, we don't really need an industry rep in that process. We absolutely have several venues in which we engage industry. We just had the BISA executive working group just 2 weeks ago. Eric and all the captains of industry were out. So we have those venues. We need that feedback, particularly what I call business intelligence, because we have to know that component of the capability set is viable and healthy, and we have to understand those networks. So from that perspective, absolutely, but from the design perspective on material development, I defer to, you know, I defer to the folks that do that.
Yes, sir. Sure, Mr. Ebling, any comments on that?
Sure. So we do have these executive work groups, and when there's more sensitive information in play, we also have joint planning groups called JPAGs that we can also do. The business intelligence, you know, we try to stay very close with our partners at Transcom. I would say the most important thing for industry to know is forecasting. What are the current requirements? What are the emerging requirements? So that we can best tailor our fleet and our services to meet the requirements of the government.
Thank you, sir. Sir, another question, sir, over to Transcom again. From Transcom's perspective, who are the enabling units that a battalion brigade should engage for deployment assistance? Conversely, from an installation perspective, what role should garrison operations be prepared to play?
Yeah, and that's really not a Transcom question, because as you know, MCOM, with all the enterprise partners, including Army Materiel Command, has the force projection outload tasks associated with that. SDDC plays a huge role in all that, but from a joint perspective, you know.
Kind of more of an LRC, AXIM,
right.
MCOM.
Really,
yes, sir. Sir, I have another Transcom.
But, you know, if I could, I'm sorry, and if I didn't answer the question, please come back. I do want to say, though, for folks that may not realize it, this CDRE that General Donahue was talking about was really the result of General Perna coming to Transcom back in August and saying, hey, Transcom, you know, you got this thing called turbo activation. You do it anyway, because we have to activate the fleet, right, because we want to make sure they're ready. He said, why don't we tie that with an outload that Forcecom has? And so that level of initiative and discussion is what's leading to a lot of this energy here. So I just wanted to thank the G4 for that.
If I can answer that preceding question, really the ESC that supports the core is where you start. And they'll get the right people from the right component to help with the outload requirements. It could be the 7th Trans Brigade out of Fort Eustis, or it could be a U.S. Army Reserve unit. But work within the chain of command that we have, and that the ESC is really the place that is a good start if you need to start somewhere.
Yes, sir. Thank you. So I do want to come back to Transcom. I think it's yours, so you'll let me know if it's not.
I'll make it up.
All right, sir. As one of the components of the national highway system, interstate highways improve the mobility of military troops to and from the various ports. In 2014, America's civil engineers gave the infrastructure an overall grade of D+, D-, which shows a bunch of physical problems. In your opinion, what are our most critical vulnerabilities, and how might these impact our ability to protect the Army?
Yeah, that's a great question. And there's some, you know, there's the DOT version of the highway assessment, and then there's the Transportation Engineering Agency's version, which is directly linked to the national defense and our requirements for national defense. There's been several studies done on that. You know, the most recent one I looked at, frankly, we're actually in fairly reasonably good stead with regards to highways in support of national defense. There are 17 designated strategic ports out there, commercial ports in addition to military ports. SDDC designates strategic ports and conducts those assessments as well. And so overarching in terms of infrastructure in that regard, with the exception of what we're doing in the ammo port up in Matka, what the Army's doing there, we're in pretty good shape. We are looking, though, at vulnerabilities into the future. We spent a lot of time thinking about that. And the one that really transcends the network that we're most concerned about, to be honest with you, is cyber vulnerabilities across the non-.mil entities that we depend on.
Okay, sir, thank you. Sir, General Perna, sir. In your recent article, Projecting an Expeditionary Army, you address 80% of the Army's early entry enablers are in the Guard and Reserve. What impacts do you see in affecting the Army's ability to conduct deployment operations?
So General Donahue listed off some of the units that the capabilities that are required to be part of the first deployers, and primary part of the mission is to help us depart CONUS and then receive us where we're at. And so the key struggle is their ability to be ready to go to execute the mission in the timeline. Their capabilities, I'm confident in, they've demonstrated it clearly over the last 10 to 14 years. And we walked away from those efforts understanding that it takes the total force to do it, right? All three compos. And so what we just need to do is be able to identify the units that we need, apply them to the new sustainment readiness model, and then just make sure that we're tracking the readiness to execute the mission. I feel confident we can do this, right? Again, it's seeing ourselves and then applying the leadership necessary to do it.
So meeting the COCOM requirements for in that regard is a FORSCOM mission. And we do, we have worked the O-Plan demands, and we're identifying by unit type what has to be ready when. And then we're looking through, in January we did this, we're identifying, if we had to execute like a PACOM O-Plan this month, who would we send? And so we're identifying those units, and we're making sure that they can meet the readiness requirements of the O-Plan. So this is what I was talking about, how it's a change for how we're building readiness within Forces Command. We are looking at the surge requirements first and then working on the rotational demand. So, yes, agree completely with what General Perna said, and that's how we're doing it in Forces Command.
Sir General Donahue, somewhat of a follow-on question, if you would, sir. We're hearing a discussion about sustainable readiness. And how does that differ from R4GEN, and what are the implications for deployment and deployable readiness?
Okay, R4GEN was built for a rotational demand model that was very busy. And that brigade talked about that, you know, had it lad 14 months from now, it didn't have to worry about being ready tonight. It had to be ready 14 months from now. And we let them do that. We didn't man them properly. We didn't equip them then. It'd be ready. We got ready just for the CTC rotation. We didn't make them train hard. We didn't make them train all their tasks. And we're changing that with our approach to being surge ready.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Eblin, sir, does the Army operate in a way that matches commercial operating capabilities? And does our deployment process focus on the right things, in your opinion?
That's a loaded question, I think.
We're here to
learn. That's why we picked you.
We're here to learn.
I would say that the Army's model does not match commercial industry's model from a purely commercial standpoint. But I would say that the U.S. flag commercial fleet really exists to support the requirements of the Department of Defense. And so carriers like us and the other U.S. flag international carriers, we specialize in this, basically. But for military sea lift requirements, there really is no compelling reason to operate ships under U.S. flag, because it is certainly not economically competitive. So we've learned a lot, particularly over the last 10, 12, 13 years that we've been in the fight. I think we've learned how to operate better together. And I think everybody recognizes that the Army's equipment does deploy on commercial ships, not solely on commercial ships, of course. We do have the surge and reserve fleet, but it is important to note that we've learned to work better together, I would say.
Thank you, sir. Sir, Mr. Signorelli, sir, what are your, you may have already discussed this briefly, what are your recommendations for requirements writers that would help the Army design vehicles with increased deployability on, regardless of the mode of transportation?
So I think the recommendation isn't just about deployability. It's about developing requirements. And I think the first step there is really sitting down and understanding the second and third order impacts of requirements that get written. As I talked about, you know, the one change in the size of the mannequin used for human factors engineering has a huge ripple effect through the design of the entire system. And I think that really takes a focused engagement with industry to truly understand what the capabilities are that industry can deliver, what the impacts of those capabilities are on conceptual system design, and then what the integrated set of requirements to deliver or the impact is. Around deployability specifically, I think that there's a lack of understanding that weight is not a linear function, that there are, it's a series of step functions. And within each one of those steps, you can add capability. But once you reach that next limit, it's about a 10 to 12 ton step up to that next weight category. And there isn't anything in between because at that point you've reached, you've got to add more propulsion, more power, more suspension, more armor. And so there's a step function in there. And sometimes it's trying to achieve the corner of the envelope performance that that really drives us to those major step changes in system size and weight. But again, that takes some very detailed and thoughtful analysis of what an integrated set of requirements looks like.
That's excellent.
Well, thank you, sir. That was great.
Excellent comment.
General Donahue, sir, what are some of the main challenges in force combat units to build deployment readiness? I think this could be a function of time to train deployment readiness.
Okay, so strangely enough, one of the things that, that are really preventing us from training in general and in any area is excess. Right now in Forces Command, we have about 1.08 million pieces of excess equipment in our units. And that's from drawing down the 4th Brigade in every division, from MTO changes, from activations that we've done, been doing at a pretty steady rate in the last 3 years. And so that equipment is piling up at our installations. And so our units are now trying to focus on managing that excess and getting rid of it. Unfortunately, about 80% of it is still required by somebody in the Army. So we just can't send a Sierra, have a train show up and get rid of it that way. It requires those units to bring it up to 1020 standard. That costs money and time. It requires, you know, the documents to get accepted and processed, and takes time. It's becoming a major effort. And actually, the G4 issued with the G3 headquarters DA order this year to help us with this problem. But it's going to require our units to almost stand down to focus on this. And it's really, it's become a real problem with the units now. One division has like 1,200 extra trucks. And they're working their best, and they're getting rid of 40 a week, and so we got to help them do better than that. And because we're still paying money on keeping those trucks up, they're sitting in a motor pool, and they're taking time away from units that should be trained to do something else. So strangely enough, excess is keeping us from being trained and ready to do things to include being able to deploy.
Okay. Sir, any General Perlman, would you like to comment on excess?
Oh, so the total numbers for the room is, we have roughly 900,000 pieces of equipment that we're moving around to fill shortages in units. And then we have 1.2 million pieces of total excess to the Army. And as General Donahue talked about, this is a problem that's been going on for a little while now, and it's the focus of the commanders that's helping us see the problem and then get rid of it so that we can focus on the right things. So it is a tremendous effort going on in the total Army right now. And oh, yeah, by the way, Transcom's helping us with this, this part of the problem. So
yes, sir.
Because nothing moves for free.
And AMC, sir, thank you.
And DLA has also been great partners in helping
DLA,
us get
absolutely.
Too. So really it's a joint capability to do that. General Lyons, sir. What are your major concerns pertaining to the readiness of the Joint Deployment Distribution Enterprise?
I think you may have missed an opportunity. I thought that was a segue to ask me a question about rates.
No, sir, that's a different
so
panel.
I appreciate that.
That one's coming.
No.
Right before we get
on. No, you know, they are.
Panel,
I think the really the greatest challenge to the Joint Deployment Distribution Enterprise is about how we think about the future in contested domains. I think that's a game changer. So if you don't know, all of our campaign analysis that we do, all of our subsequent transportation feasibility analysis is based on, impunity, that we're going to operate with impunity. There's no attrition built into any of that. And we believe that we've got emerging actors out there that will compete in that space. And so that I think, is our biggest challenge. And to your to the work you're doing, Steve, and thanks for doing it, we are looking at business process reform across Transcom. We've set up a team to look at that, and how do we adequately resource the JDDE in the future, really kind of over the horizon. General McDuse got us thinking about that. So we don't want to, you know, we don't want to make budget year decisions that mortgages the future of the enterprise. We're having those kind of discussions too, and I know you're helping with that, so I appreciate it.
Sir, thank you. I've got one here for General Donahue, sir.
Okay.
I think you're the right person to answer this, so we'll give it a shot. Pre-deployment activities, but it really deals with ForceCom and the series of heel-to-toe deployments that ForceCom has ongoing right now in Korea and are about to start in other places in the world and certainly doing in the Middle East. And the question is dealing with interoperability with our allies. So what are we learning? What steps are we taking? What else do we need to do, sir, in your opinion, to develop better interoperability with our allies?
Okay, so this is an active effort across the Army to do this at every level. We try to be interoperable with our allies and our partners in Africa, in Europe, and in Korea. It's not something new, but something that's becoming more and more re-energized, especially in Europe, as we recognize that the threat there has changed and it's going to require, you know, a NATO integrated response to manage it. And so we're supporting, from Forces Command points of view, all of our CTC rotations, we try to bring in at least a company size element from some foreign army. We've had Brits, Canadians, Japanese, Koreans, Senegalese. We're starting to see them at our CTCs. That's forcing the brigade to handle that dynamic. How do you interoperate with a partner who's not able to access your SIPR-based systems, mission command systems? How do you issue, you know, things that, you know, we used to be pretty good at doing in the Cold War days, but how do you issue a Korean company in order to follow and assume the main effort, and how you do that? And so we're giving our commanders the opportunity to work through those types of challenges at our combat training centers and through the exercises. We're having great exercises in Europe, for instance, this summer in Poland, Anaconda. We'll have plenty of opportunities for our 4th Infantry Division, numerous guard brigades and divisions, and the 82nd Airborne Division to interoperate with our allies in Europe to work through some of the challenges you're talking about. So it is an ongoing process, and the first step to accomplish that process is to acknowledge that it is very important, which is what we've done.
Sure, thank you. General Lyons, sir.
I would like to add to that. But it also extends beyond the military to commercial entities. The work that Army Materiel Command is doing through Army Sustainment Command to develop task orders for service support in each of the continents is allowing us to set conditions for future requirements. You know, the contacts that they are making and developing that we will use later on will pay for itself over and over again. And this is incredibly important as we talk about strategic deployment and our ability to execute it, because what do we need to take and what do we have to take will be a big part of getting there when we need to be there. So I just want to applaud those efforts, because it is going to be a game changer for us.
Yes, sir.
Could I jump in on that too?
Absolutely.
So interoperability was mentioned earlier, and I think it's important to take a step back and make note of the tremendous asymmetric advantage that we all have that comes with the capabilities that come under the TRANSCOM umbrella, not just sea lift, but also airlift and surface. It is a tremendous ability that we bring to the fight collectively. And I think it's important to bear in mind the interoperability aspects of those pieces of it as well. So.
Yeah. Sir, thank you. General Lyons, sir, do you and TRANSCOM have the authority to use non-U.S. flagged ships to carry troops to the fight?
For troop carrying, the answer would be no. Okay. For cargo carrying, the answer would be yes, if we have to, but it would be a last resort. And on the surface side, on the sea lift side, the answer is no. But troops are predominantly moving by
air. Yes, sir.
So they'd be moving on our craft partner passenger planes.
Sure. We've got again, some questions that we're not going to get to, but three or four from Deal, sir, with configured loads and ASLs and support in theater. Sir, I know, General Perna, sir, you've done a lot of thinking on this recently. So without reading five or six different questions, would you give the panel and give the audience your thoughts on where we're going with ASLs and if you would, loads in general?
So the key word is expeditionary. And again, we as General Donahue said, we've taken ourselves out of this approach as we, you know, we had to make certain decisions to fight the two wars we were in. But if you understand what expeditionary means, crossing the line of departure in 2003 into from a stable base into combat operations without any support outside of the soldiers that you've trained and the equipment that you've ensured is ready is where your mind has to be on this. And so then we have to think about what does that mean? And in particular, the example General Shapiro mentioned was, how do we prepare our Army stockage list, our repair parts, to sustain operations long enough for the supply chain to catch up to it? And so are we ready to have the right stockage list that will maintain our equipment for a period of time to be determined? And more importantly, do we have access to that to those repair parts? Can we store them so that they're mobile? Can we put them on wheel vehicles that we already have, because we're not going to get any more? And can we project that capability into the battlefield? This thought process is lost on us. We're very comfortable with mountains of repair parts at different layers. We're very comfortable with service support from contractors. And when we get that in that comfort zone, we make certain decisions about stockage levels, 50 days, 60 days, 90 days. If you're in an expeditionary environment and you're in contact, you are not going to be able to develop those types of stockages. And so we have to pull ourselves back, understand what that means, and start thinking through how to develop the capabilities we need to execute the mission. And this is a mindset change. And we have to do this thinking now because it will impact how we train to deploy ourselves, what we need to deploy us, what we need to receive us on the other end, and how do we project ourselves. So it's a part of the whole problem we're working through.
Yes, sir. Sir, we're down to our last a couple of minutes. I know we've got an event right after us. So I do want to turn it back over to you, sir, for anything that you'd like to say to close this out.
Yeah, so again, to AUSA, thank you for this great opportunity and the participation today. The questions were excellent and I think very helpful for us to think through this very important problem of deployment readiness. I personally want to thank the panel for your time and effort. I know it's difficult to get here, but your contributions were well received, and so thank you very much. And that's
Thanks,
all
sir.
I have.
Thank you.